Hi, I'm Joan Neuberger, editor of Not Even Past, and today our guest is Indrani Chatterjee. Hi, Indrani.
Hi, Joan.
Indrani is a new professor in the history department at UT Austin, and her field is early modern 17th and 18th century India. And she's just published a book called Forgotten Friends, Monks, Marriages, and Memories in Northeast India.
That's right.
And it's a pretty complex book because you're telling a lot of different stories. There's the story of the monasteries as communities. Mm-hmm. There's the story of the role of women in those monasteries. Mm-hmm. There's the very interesting story of the similarities between monasteries across a wide expanse of geography and also across different religions have very similar structures. And then you tell the story of the erasure of that history from our memory with the coming of English colonialism and the creation of colonial records offices.
Yeah.
So let's start with the first piece.
Okay.
The monasteries in Northeast India in the 17th and 18th century seem very different from monasteries that probably a lot of our readers think they know in Western Europe. So how are they different?
Well, they're different because not all lineages required women to be absent. So women were part of the larger group of people living inside the monasteries. But also, you know, we mustn't think of monasteries as entirely fully built up buildings only. When I talk of monasticism, I'm thinking about a complex life and political economy, at the center of which is an ordination lineage that is a teacher and a disciple, but also the disciple comes from a lay household, or there are people who are lay men and women who are followers of the teachers and therefore have sent their son or brother or nephew to that teacher. Mm-hmm. So the monastery is both an assemblage of people, a lifestyle, and related buildings. It's not a single building.
Mm-hmm. So they're much more in touch with the communities around them.
Exactly.
And you talk about the ways in which they're like a little government.
Mm.
They play a big economic role in the communities. What,
yes.
Maybe you could talk about that a bit.
Well, I started talking about them only after reading various medieval inscriptions where land grants were made to particular teachers or eminent teachers or monastic lineages. And all of these land grants gave rights to the person who is being given this land to organize cultivation, to organize the policing, the basic sovereignty of that plot of land or of those groups of tenants or cultivators. And there were specific clauses in those charters that made me think about this as a government, because otherwise, how would we think about this group of people sitting on a plot of land, doing the tasks of cultivating, transporting grain to the markets, following their teacher, giving gifts to him and sometimes her? That's the wholeness of it that I thought of as government.
And also acting as judges.
Absolutely.
And punishing criminals. And,
yes, but also healthcare, you know, the sort of pastoral aspects of every priest or teacher is very obvious from some of these documents.
And then did they also play a role in providing soldiers and workers for other parts of society?
Some other parts of society I cannot fully prove, but I certainly know that many of the lay groups, as well as the initial novitiate, as it were, in any lineage, would go from cultivating, transporting, to soldiering in a very easy move. So it's not that there were fixed, specialized roles that each of them played. And as a result, one could switch seasonally from one kind of activity to another kind of activity, depending upon the needs of the lineage in question or of the moment or of the ecology at stake, you know, in this terrain. So
one of the things we associate with Western monasteries is celibacy. And some isolation, but also celibacy, and that seems not to be at all true in these communities, or at least not entirely true.
Yes, I would say not entirely true, because the meaning of a monasterium as a set apart, you know, place or site, still did hold true relative to, say, a city or its markets. There could be a little setting apart, say, of a building or of a set of homes or huts set apart from the main way, but that they were in conversation with and communication with each other, you know, even as they were set apart, would hold. And so women were very much a part of the ways that these set apart sites were managed or provided with food and so on. So.
And some of the monks were married, is that correct?
Yes.
And some had more than one wife?
Yes.
And some of the women involved had more than one husband, right? Can you talk about that?
Well, I found that to be the case for particularly the Vaishnava and the Shaiva tantric traditions in Eastern India. That's very well known that the myth is, or the legend rather, is of Krishna, who's adored by many women, gopinis and women of the cowherd community. That's the legend. And around this legend has grown up the worship of Krishna and various modes of worshiping. And so in that context, gurus, Vaishnava gurus, could have many female subjects and gifts of the self, gifts of daughters as brides to such gurus was not unthinkable. It was in fact a revered mode of being. And that's the context in which some gurus had many female subjects who were also sexual consorts or provided certain kinds of domestic services, which is the whole range of things that we call marriage, right? But also some women had multiple partners, and it's a very well-known aspect of Himalayan life or mountain life, where one household cannot pay the entire or separate bride wealth or gifts for separate brides from different households. So they would pool together the resources of a lineage of brothers and acquire one wife who would then either live successively with the brothers or, you know, work out different models. There were different ways in which the wife then went to live with the different brothers and had children with them.
Was this a position of power for them to have a number of different husbands consecutively or at the same time? Or was she, or was it the opposite?
Well, it depends upon which time and which ecology one is looking at. Because in the, you know, 4th or 5th centuries Afghanistan terrain, from where the first records of this have been found by Nicholas Sims Williams, the terrain seems to have been a harder one. And so it providing a woman with many partners may have, in fact, provided some kind of security for the woman, but also the men's lineage appears to have got access to resources that were held by the women's household. So it's hard to tell whether it's power or whether it's a pooling of resources or whether it is ensuring survival of both sides. On the other hand, in the lowland areas where I found the same kind of set of records, I think what I found more of was that the woman, after living with the eldest brother, when the eldest brother died, would then continue to live with the younger brother or younger brothers collectively.
And that wasn't unusual in Western history either.
Right.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit more about it, because I thought it was what I had read in the, you know, in the biblical texts as well, but you tell me a little bit.
It wasn't uncommon for either spouse to, if their spouse died, to remarry a sibling.
Right. So, but in the 19th century somewhere, this pattern was being identified as incest by colonial officers.
In India?
In India.
Oh.
So, or at least it was being delegitimated on the grounds that this was incest. And so there is
and
this...
One husband, one wife, that's it.
That's
the
it.
End of story.
That's it.
Tell us a little bit about other roles that women played in these communities.
Well, certainly cultivators, very big cultivators. They took a lot of the decisions on which planting, which sowing. And which season, but also how to organize labor pools, where, which particular labor pool would go, what kind of seeds would be used, you know, how much seeds would be used or saved. That seems to be very, very widespread. And also, of course, laying out the land, preparing it, but hiring labor for transporting of the cut grain after a harvest to move it to a market, all these decisions were actually taken by women. Feeding the entire crew of laborers who were brought in, that was taken on by the women in the households of these lay households, because they seem to be doing the cooking, they seem to be doing what we would call hospitality industry. But it's actually service, because without the women being able to feed these incoming workers, the workers wouldn't be able to work. And it's you know, it would send up the costs of hiring labor if you didn't manage to feed them economically.
And so these monastic communities were often supported by a wealthy patron. Is that right?
Yes. And
sometimes those were women, right? And that's what you did, one of the things you discovered.
Yes, yes. One of the things that I discovered in the Manipuri Vaishnav tradition, the southern East Indian belt that I was looking at in the early part of the records, was that there were many women, eminent women of, you know, wealthy households who had given up their bits of land to particular monasteries or monastic settlements or temples, had provided sustained income for those gifts that they were making. So yes, they were the patrons, and only if you visited the site would a particularly scrupulous priest or record keeper point you in that direction. Those records have not been kept so well in the English archives.
Well, let's come back to that, because first I want to talk about, I'd like you to talk a little bit about how this monastic structure and culture was replicated in a lot of different religious traditions, and it's very similar in different religious traditions in this whole geographic area of northeastern India.
Yes.
And that's surprising, right?
Well,
that surprised me.
Well, yes. You know, I actually wasn't surprised once I started reading the epigraphs and then looking at subsequent periods.
What do you mean epigraphs?
Epigraphic, the grants, the various Sanskrit language charters that had been collected for the period of the 9th to the 13th centuries, and that I had fortunately managed to read a little bit in. And I began to notice that some of these charters were, you know, praising Buddhist donors, whereas the charter writer or the gift recipient was himself not a Buddhist, but a Brahmin or a Vaishnav, non-Buddhist tradition. Mm-hmm. So that alerted me right from the outset that that had always been the case, that one group had sustained another or brought in the services of another and sustained mm-hmm. them. So we were wrong in thinking that the Augsburg model, you know, post-Reformation, that sort of arrangement, that whoever was the prince, his religion prevailed as the religion of the subjects. Mm-hmm. That model was wrong. That model was, in fact, limited to Europe. It was not the model with which to think about South Asian pasts. Mm-hmm.
And what were the religions there? There was Buddhism. There was
Jainism. Mm-hmm. Then from the 7th century, there was Islam, mm-hmm. 8th century onwards. Then there were many varieties of Islam. So Sunni, Shia, and all those traditions, but also Sufis, very important Sufi lineages right from the 11th or the 14th centuries who came in with the Turkic, Afghan, and Central Asian soldiers. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, even before Buddhism, or maybe around Buddhism and Jainism, there were the Vedic religions, Vedic Hinduism, which then mutated and became different kinds of Hinduism. So Vaishnavism, or 15th century, a response to all these new incoming religions and the regeneration or remaking or reform of a certain kind of Vedic religions to different groups of, you know, Vaishnav, more emotional religions, more ritually based, more singing and performative religions, mother worship or female goddess worship, a very, very important terrain that united, older religions in that region with an ongoing what we call Shakta traditions. That mm-hmm. is, the female principle is treated as Shakti or energy. Mm-hmm. And without that female principle, nothing moves in the universe. Mm-hmm. So females are associated with energy, and that tradition has been a very important sort of way of working with what appeared to be all male traditions. Mm-hmm. And so Buddhism, as in alliance with Shakta traditions, becomes also Tantric Buddhism. Vaishnavism with the Shakta traditions becomes Sahajiya, that is a simple, easy to access religion. So all of these have been also ideologically and in monastic, organizational terms, constantly trying to merge with each other mm-hmm. and trying to translate one into another.
That's so interesting. And moving on to the historiographical part of your book,
right.
The British colonial powers come in and erase this entire history from the records. Is that right?
If they don't quite erase it, they pick and choose mm-hmm. which parts they will mm-hmm. take forward.
And then what do? They sort of say, this is going to be, in this period we have one dominant religion, and women, we're going to totally forget about women's important roles.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, part of it was that the English East India Company came in and were given the rights to also settle in three provinces in the Eastern Belt. And they were supposed to simply collect taxes and sustain themselves, like other soldiers mm-hmm. and traders had before them. Mm-hmm. But then the English East India Company's needs were different, and they were plugged into a different global market. And so what began to happen very early on was that they began to treat these little plots of land that were held by the monasteries and monastic assemblages mm-hmm. as tax-free lands, really. You remember, I said that there were charters which said you can do your own policing, you can organize your own cultivation, etc. So I think those sort of little sovereignties began to both physically stand in the way of East India Company's desire for connected trade routes, but also began to actually appear as impediments to the totalization of revenue collection, you know, in any one region. And so
the East India Company wanted to profit from their
precisely
activities,
yeah. From their holdings, from whatever. So they wanted to tax fully and completely. They didn't want any of these tax exempt people and terrain in their domains. And that's where the first thrusts come. They want to, you know, negate all these exemptions given to the teachers and monasteries and monastic assemblages.
And then do they enforce a different set of social roles in these in these lands that they begin cultivating?
Yes, they do. And they want to ensure that all the lands are in the names of only men. Because for the British, it is about getting hold of particular individuals and punishing them or putting them in prison or getting the money out of them somehow. And women are harder to get at, partly because such women who would hold title to land would also be protected by socially and by the spatial arrangement of their lives. They would be this is the terrain that is called the haram or the household, the antahpur, the interior of a household, where they are the heart and they're surrounded by various layers of protection, men and, you know, service corps of different kinds. So it would be harder to get hold of women anyway. So women, on the other hand, were also organizing some of the resistance against this. And by 1781, we know there are many records of women, elderly women, sitting inside various households, patrons of these monastic lineages, who were clearly opposed to the incoming British East India Company regime. So by law, the English East India Company ensured that none of these women would have the rights to land or property in their names anymore. And by 1790, that was had become universal law in this company-ruled government and company-ruled lands.
And then, do they bring tea cultivation, or do they just expand it? They bring it.
Tea, I think, was known in the region at least east of the Ganges. Because in 1855, they found wild growing tea in lands that, you know, they had just acquired. So clearly tea had been known and had been cultivated off and on. I am not fully certain about how widely cultivated it was earlier.
But they really expand it and create these big sort of agribusiness farms.
Yes, the making of agribusiness or commercialization of agriculture, that is specific to English or British rule from 1833 onwards in this easternmost part of the lands that we are calling Northeast India today.
And were women the main laborers on the tea plantations? You described the regime as being pretty brutal.
Yes. From the records themselves of the tea planters in the 1860s, you can tell that they're counting how many people are dying amongst the laborers, how many are falling ill. It is pretty rough. But there is a very, very large number of women who are being brought up from the plains of India, central India, from about 1830s, 1840s. Many of those central Indian settlements are also being destroyed at the same time by British armies marching through, annexing the lands, and people on the lands are being sent on and out to Eastern India to work as laborers, but also some of them were sent off to Mauritius and all the sugar plantations around this time, post 1838, the abolition of slavery in, you know, plantation societies. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the post-slavery labor is also coming from the same labor pool in Central and Eastern India. One set is going off or being sent off to plantations in the Atlantic world, sugar plantations, and another set is being sent off to tea plantations, also held by European capital from 1840s and 50s in this northeastern belt.
Now, what happens to make the record of the pre-East India Company regime so obscure and so hard to find? What happened to make historians forget the story of this religious interaction and strong female roles and monastic community?
You know, I'm still struggling to get to the bottom of how completely they were forgotten. Mm-hmm. And my hunch is that, or at least what I have been able to establish so far, is that many of the lands that the British took over and then employed some Indians to do some basic auxiliary work, those Indians actually developed stakes in maintaining the colonial regime, both on the land and in the records. And so the past that had lost out, the women, all of those stories began to be only recovered after 1985, you know, after the International Year of the Women, after various women's groups began to look for those records and started translating them into English again, etc. But by that time, a lot of the records of the early, late 17th and early 18th centuries had been either organized in very hard to access sites, such as the National Archives of India, or in Britain, in London, mm-hmm. in the India Office Library. So getting access to the 18th century records became almost impossible. Mm-hmm. So there was a physical access that was hard. The languages were lost. Many of the languages were very complex languages. You know, the scripts were Arabic script, but Persian language, Urdu language records. There were also Tibetan terms and scripts in there, which most people in Eastern India had forgotten by them, mm-hmm. because they had been
homogenized,
right? Yeah. So being able to recognize a Tibetan word for what the history of this word was, how it arrived here in this language, that's been lost. There were so many different scripts that had been forgotten, lost.
And how did you begin to become interested in, or even know that there was something there to recover?
How I began was because I was sitting in schools and colleges learning a history that made me extremely uncomfortable, that I could see had painted my own grandmothers as savages and tribals, and I was extremely uncomfortable with what was coming down to me. But I had no way of trying to tell a different story without learning the languages. Mm-hmm. And I had no way of learning the languages without traveling in those terrains. Mm-hmm. And so I've actually had to work very hard and against the common thread of my own profession, my generation. You know, they were all doing very theoretical, hip and happening stuff. And I was in the boondocks learning languages and traveling and unearthing or trying to photograph these various sites, trying to learn from those very people who had been dismissed as tribals and savages. Mm-hmm. So I was spending a lot of time actually in the field rather than in the classroom.
In the villages of Northeast India where you traveled and were looking for documents, did you find a kind of oral tradition that remembered, that leapfrogged over the colonial history and remembered the past? Did you find a resistance to it?
Residual stuff, not a lot of it. I must say that, you know, there have been very heroic attempts to recover or hang on to or publish some of those old songs, poems, in the vernacular language traditions. That's been ongoing for a very long time, and I'm very grateful to a million such small presses, small self-propelled collectors who have tried to hang on to those stories. And so trying and finding them was the big task for me. And, you know, I didn't grow up in Calcutta also. I was born of refugee parents who grew up everywhere else. So
refugees from?
From what became East Pakistan.
And now Bangladesh.
And now is Bangladesh. So I'm also born to refugees. So they didn't have a great deal of wealth to spare for, you know, putting me through various kinds of language learning schools, etc. I'm grateful for everything that came my way, but it was hard going and it took a lot of time. And but I learned Farsi. I then understood that I had a lot more to learn. And
that's always the way, right?
Yeah.
As soon as you learn something, you realize how much more there is that you need to know.
Absolutely. But it made me very appreciative of all those people who had worked in the Persian records and made me reach out to them, learn from them. And as a result of that, I was led on to the early part of the South Asian history where Sultanate, that is Central Asian slave sultans had come into this terrain and had also built institutions with different groups of people. So in the course of reading there, I stumbled onto this whole historiography of Tibet, which nobody in my generation had taught me. I had not learned any of this in any school, college, university curriculum. Any part.
So and yet it was really intertwined in the whole region of
what
we think of as South Asia.
Yes. And it came as such a big shock to me when I discovered that so many parts of what I thought was my, you know, native Bengali script was also shared with Tibetan script. And that gave me pause. So then I relearned the history of language a little, relearned or learned Tibetan script, or at least classical Tibetan or central Tibetan, because once you start learning Tibetan, you know that there have been many different scripts as well, and many different languages. And, you know, there is no end to learning.
No, there is no end to learning. That's a great place to stop. Thank you very much, Indrani. It's a fascinating story.
Thank you so much for having me.